Let me, a flowery band to bind us to the earth, this I have explained to you, spite of despondence, of the inhuman dearth, which we don't find. Unfortunately, there are certain vices instead of virtues that we see in human beings around that makes us worry also. Of noble natures, of the gloomy days, your sad days, days when you are sad. Of all the unhealthy and over-darkened ways. Over-darkened refers to, again, the grey side of human life, where you are not having happiness, you are finding those things which should not be termed as a which is not the virtue of a human being. But John Keats mentions here that if you ever come across such kind of a thing, please always remember, and that is to have a thing of beauty in your mind, in your heart, that can bring happiness, that can bring happiness. And see what more lines he has mentioned, what he has written here, and how nicely he has written here. Of all the unhealthy and over-darkened ways made for our searching, we are searching everywhere, we are searching everywhere. Happiness. What are we searching everywhere? We are searching everywhere happiness. Yes, in spite of all, some shape of beauty moves away the pall from our dark spirits. Pall, P-A-L-L. What does it refers to here? Dark clouds, thick dark clouds. Suddenly, all these clouds get vanished somewhere. Where do they go? No one of us can actually say so. But it's again only and only one thing which he's correlating with his stanza one, and that is a thing of beauty. If you see ever once in those times when you are not seen, when you see despair, unhappiness, you will find your spirits high, even if you are coming across some bad things. Trees, well, I think I've skipped one line. From our dark spirits, such the sun, the moon, trees old and young, sprouting a shady boon. Now, he's talking here about universal things. He's talking here about mystical things. He's talking here about heavenly, beautiful things which are created by God, the sun, the moon. He's talking here also about nature, old trees, young trees. These trees are sprinting all are sprinting and sprouting. He has mentioned here sprouting. Sprouting means that we see them. We see growth coming out of seeds. We see young trees. We see old trees. We see sun. We see moon. And yes, he's talking here about happiness, that they also are source of happiness. They are also providing us happiness. A shady boon, boon, B-O-O-N, boon. Boon here refers to a kind of blessing. Boon here refers to a kind of blessing for simple sheep. Now children, here we are talking about divine beauty. We are talking here about divine beauty. What it is all about, I'll explain you. For simple sheep, and such are daffodils, with the green world they live in, and clear rills. Rills here refers to streams, refers to your streams, your rivers, that for themselves a cooling covert make gainst the hot season, the mid-forest break. Now, as I informed you once, when we see the stanzas starting, page 99, for simple sheep, why sheep only is mentioned here? Have you ever questioned yourself that why John Keats has clearly mentioned here about flock of sheep? What is the reason behind it? The reason is because he is correlating it with Christianity. He is here talking about Jesus Christ, who was often seen with the flock of sheep all around him, and he used to be in the center. Sheep is considered to be associated to be a calm animal, and such are daffodils, beautiful flowers that we can see. They are grown somewhere near the river, and they are giving us happiness, coolness. The effect of coolness is something that can be seen with the green world they live in. Green world refers to, of course, yes, sheep can be seen in greenery, daffodils, of course, yes, when we talk about the green world, refers to, and even in two lines, if you read, he has mentioned sprouting a shady boon. He is mentioning here about trees, about greenery, about nature, and for someone, it can be God, but for him, the beauty of nature is something that he is romanticizing. And that is the reason he's called as a romantic poet and not as a nature poet. Often students write so. But yes, we regard William Wordsworth as a nature poet. But when we talk about John Keats, he's somebody who's regarded as a romantic poet who believes that beauty is truth and truth is beauty. Beauty is truth and truth is beauty. And this is what you can see. Nature is also seen as a symbol of beauty, which is why he is called as romanticizing the nature also. That for themselves, dear students, as I informed you about the Greek myth associated with Endymion, associated with Mount Letmos, associated with this goddess Cynthia, who descended from the heavens, and she's the one who kissed Endymion on his forehead, and it is this Endymion who is moving here and there in search of that beauty, because he experienced that beauty for a fraction of a second, but that beauty is not making him to sleep even for a day. He's searching that thing of beauty each and everywhere. Each and everywhere means in the forest. He's searching that while looking into these beautiful heavenly bodies like sun, moon, in nature. But alas, he's not able to find that beauty that he saw, that he experienced for a fraction of a second. And let's move on further. What more is written here by John Keats? That for themselves, well, let me read a line before. With the green world they live in, and clear rills, I informed you, refers to stream. Clear rills, water is so clear that we can see the reflection of nature around in the water. So clear rills we can see. That for themselves, a cooling covert, well, you all know covert and overt behavior. We often talk about something that is under the cover is termed as, within double inverted commas, as a covert thing, something that is coverted. And overt, of course, the opposite of it, something which is obvious, something which is visible to anyone from outside. But something is under the cover and he wants to let it come out. He refers to here the young shepherd. Wants, Endymion wishes to uncover the beauty. He wants to make that beauty to come out. And what he mentions here, what John Keats is mentioning here, symbolizing by stating what Endymion wants, that for themselves a cooling covert make against the hot season. There is a comparison now. These four lines, if you see, you'll find a comparison. Simple sheep and such are daffodils, clear rills, coolness everywhere. But all of a sudden in this particular stanza, and if we see about this particular part, against the hot season, all of a sudden we find that there is warmth. There is something that has caused so much of the temperature to rise. The mid-forest brake. Brake refers to thick mass of ferns that are there in the forests, and before the forest starts, you'll find these ferns coming up all where, rich with sprinkling of fair musk rose, a variety of rose, musk rose blooms. You can see beautiful roses which are blooming everywhere and are spreading. Roses are spreading fragrance each and everywhere. And again, roses are a thing of beauty, a joy forever. A thing of beauty is a joy forever, even in this hot weather. If he has to say something, he can surely, yes, take into account these beautiful musk roses which are blooming everywhere. And such too, he's going to almost at an another level to state something. And what is he stating here? John Keats. And such too is the grandeur of the dooms. Of the dooms, somebody like us will definitely question dooms. Those people who are now no more, who are in their dooms, who are lying down in their coffins, what can be a source of happiness there? What can be a thing of beauty they are unable to understand? What can it be? What can it be? Aren't you surprised here? But let me tell you, students, he is going at that level. He is informing us that he can see the splendor. He can see the grandeur of those mighty kings, of mighty knights, K-N-I-G-H-T-S, kings, the ones who lived their life with dignity and they died also with dignity. They did something great in their lives that today, even if we talk about their dooms have all the more become respectful. Let's read these lines and try to understand the meaning, and let's make the meaning more clear. And such too is the grandeur of the dooms we have imagined for the mighty dead. Ma'am, I have my maths right now, so I'm leaving. Okay, please carry on with whatever work you have. We have imagined for the mighty dead all lovely tales that we have heard or read, an endless fountain of immortal drink pouring onto us from the heaven's brink. Harshal, please continue. Heaven's brink refers to that particular point from where we see that when we talk about this beautiful brink, it is referring to that particular point from where our heaven actually starts. So in these lines, what are we understanding? What are we understanding? As I told you, the context related to dooms, context related to those people who are now no more, but yes, their lives, they have lived their lives in such a way that we have a lot to learn. Isn't it mentioned here, dear students? All lovely tales, T-A-L-E-S, all lovely tales. Tales here refers to that they are the ones who are telling their stories. These might